So we are in lecture 6 of this AC Krishna series on building services to electrical services and illumination. Lecture 6 also means that we are in module 2, subheading 1, the second segment of subheading 1. In the previous class, previous session, we looked at the movement of electricity, the distribution of electricity within the building premises. And we also, I told you that we are missing some of those links, which is UPS, server power requirements, critical areas, power requirement for critical areas and all that. So we will try to cover that in this session. And another thing we will look in this session will be the wiring system, the wiring installations. So moving on directly to UPS. So UPS, like I told you in the previous session, it is uninterrupted power supply, right? Before we get into the types of UPS, I would want to make it very clear. UPS is not actually going to provide power for a longer time. So we spoke about transformer. The government supply comes in, we have transformer first, and the facility gets energized from the government supply, step down or step up, and then build entire building is fed. And now when there is a cut in the government's power supply, that is when this feeding from the transformer to the facility is getting affected. But I also told you that is when we are going to rely upon our DG, generator sets, certain generator backups. So when there is a cut in the government power supply, this automatically, the generator is automatically going to give us the power. So what is the work of UPS here? So you have regular power supply from the government, and when there is a failure in the government power supply, or DG or any backup system is going to give us the power. What exactly is the UPS doing here, right? So UPS, as it stands for uninterrupted power supply, is to provide an uninterrupted power supply. That means when the government power supply goes off and the DG switches on, there is going to be a fraction of seconds or a set of seconds where there is not going to be power, because for the DG to switch on, so the DG has to receive signal that the government power supply has failed, and so this has to switch it on by itself. And in between these two operations, where the DG senses a failure in the government power supply and when it switches itself on, the fraction of second, the microseconds, milliseconds that we have here, who is going to power up the equipment, the facility? When you have critical operations going on, like I told you, in a hospital, when you have an operation on, you can't afford to miss those couple of seconds as well. And that is when a UPS come into picture. So as soon as the DG switches on, the UPS probably will go back to its readiness mode. The UPS will mostly be kept ready, for it is going to power up quickly for a fraction of seconds or a couple of seconds, a very short period of time. So it will be always power ready. So it has to be charged in all times when there is a constant regular power supply from the government. It has to be always charged during idle times, and when there is a power supply failure, the UPS will quickly give its hand between the power supply failure from the government and the DG switching on. Right. Another thing why we can't run the entire facility with just UPS is because these are a series of batteries, DC batteries. To achieve a great load, very high load that we use for our offices or commercial buildings, it is really, really going to be huge in terms of the number of UPS batteries that we would require to power up such a big facility, right? So it can only provide a very short span of power for a very short span of time, and so it has to be used wisely. Used wisely meaning designed and planned carefully according to the usage, right? But at the same time, we can still ask this question that we have in a house, we still use it to power a regular day-to-day appliances for a longer period of time. So if we have to get into the numbers, we will get our Wi-Fi connected, tube lights connected, fan connected, TVs connected. What else are we using it? What else can you think of that we are using? And a couple of plug points, right? So if in the last chapter we'll talk about the load calculation, but how much is there? How much is the numbers going to come? We have a huge battery or a couple of batteries, and the appliances that we use is not really great or huge in terms of the number when it comes to the power consumption and wattage, right? So the purpose of UPS that we have in our households is going to be different, whereas when you're talking about the same UPS in really large facilities, the entire purpose is different, right? So with this understanding, making this really clear, we would jump into the types of UPS. The basic standby UPS is uninterruptible power source that delivers short-term battery-sourced power during power outages, right? So this is a standard one, is the standby UPS. Next is online UPS. Third is line interactive UPS. So hardware, so under standby UPS, hardware receives utility power under normal conditions through a direct AC connection. The standby unit and its inverter are essentially on hold until the backup power is really needed. So this is what I said, they are always in a ready mode. So they need to be charged always through a direct AC connection, and they are essentially on hold. They don't do, they are just kept ready so that when there is a power, when there is a backup power that is needed. Can also safeguard data and sensitive equipment from surges, spikes, dips. When there are sensitive equipment, sometimes these days most of us use laptops, so during a power connection our data gets saved. So those who of you still using desktop will understand the problem of a desktop and the data getting lost during a power failure. That is why we use this inverter, which is again UPS inverter, which is again a battery, which can help us save the data before we shut down our systems, right? So commonly used to protect computers, modem, VoIP, voice over internet protocol equipments, and other hardwares. Least expensive, also referred to as online UPS. So this is the one that we mostly use in our household as well, right? So online UPS, moving on to the next category, which is an online UPS. Is a type of uninterruptible power supply that utilizes either a double or delta conversion technology. Network equipment does not receive electricity directly from the AC outlet. Okay, so this is not going to receive direct electricity from AC circuit. AC power travels to a rectifier where it becomes DC, then the battery, then an inverter. Right? After inversion back to AC, power is delivered to equipment. Creates an energy efficient online UPS system where some power skips the processing steps. Circuit is seamless, but it's more expensive, right? If the definition is clear, it is not going to the entire device or equipment is not going to get charged through AC directly. We have a rectifier where it is converted to DC, then the battery, then an inverter. Inversion back to AC, that power is being delivered to the equipment. And energy efficient, so this creates an energy efficient online UPS system where some power still skips some of these processing steps. The circuit is seamless, and so it is more expensive. A line interactive UPS is one type of again UPS that can regulate voltage automatically. The technology responds to high low voltage, responds to both high and low voltage conditions. Unit also supports systems during outages without battery drainage. Inverter or converter technology allows the unit's battery to be charged throughout normal operations. During an outage, UPS converts battery power to AC flow for device delivery. So this is majorly used for power fluctuations. And also this can also be used for when during a power outage, this UPS converts battery power to AC so that it can deliver to the line or device directly. So these are the three types of UPS. Now we'll move on to the sizing of UPS. UPS, usually the rating, we've been talking about volts, amperes, which is current, and wattage is W, which is power. Now in the last session we spoke about kilowatt hour, right? in terms of power consumption. So UPS is typically rated by volts amps, which is again similar to the power that we calculate. It is the voltage and current supplied by the UPS to the equipment. Miscalculation in draining the UPS to beyond its capacity, then you risk the shortening of service life of the UPS batteries and worse. So it has a capacity to, like all other devices, we have a capacity limit here. So when you do a miscalculation in a calculation, and when we start using it beyond its capacity, we are going to make UPS batteries worse. One of the important things to be considered is the power requirement. For example, to operate three fans, three tube lights, three LED lights, one television and one refrigerator at the time of power failure, the power consumed by these items will be the total power consumed by these individually, right? So we have this wattages, which comes to 596 watts. So this is the calculation that we are talking about. The volt amp rating for the UPS through which you want to operate all of these, right, has to take this wattage into consideration, number one. We will move on to the next slide. The UPS is usually recommended for running energy backup for light, ceiling fans, computer, television, etc. Operating refrigerator, washing machine, air conditioner, etc. will call for a bigger capacity or increase in the capacity of a UPS. Right? So the previous slide we spoke about a fan, tube light, LED light, LED television, and refrigerator, in which I see only the refrigerator as a highly rated. Okay, refrigerator 140 watts. Yeah, right. So rest is all relatively less. So we move on further. The appliances need more voltage amps. So we have also discussed about this volt amps rating. So appliances that need more volt amp rating than the power requirement in watts due to the nature of the devices. This ratio is called power vector. So basically these appliances actually need more volt amp ratio than what is volt amp requirement than what is specified or what we are arriving at in the wattage calculation. So the ratio is called the power factor, right? Hence power supply or the VA rating of the UPS will be power requirement, which we have calculated, divided by the power factor. This power factor is usually a concept which is given in our standards or by the local electricity supplier. Usually the power factor for electrical power factor for homes will be from this range. So let's take 0.7 as the number for calculations. So what we got here in this wattages of the total equipments that we are going to operate, which is a power requirement, is 596 divided by our power factor is going to give you the volt amps rating of the UPS. So to operate these set of requirements, to satisfy these set of requirements, we will need a UPS with at least 900 volt amp requirement rating. So yes, so this is what it is. Moving on further, so we have a definition and we have a quick comparison between UPS and an inverter. UPS allows the power to flow through the system so that the data can be saved before the primary supply is fully shut down. Protects the system from power surges, because we studied about three types of UPS. Has a battery which connects with power supply of devices during power loss from the mains. The circuit consists of an inverter, the battery, and the controller. The UPS converts the AC to DC using rectifier and DC to AC using an inverter. And the inverter, so what is an inverter? So over here we understand AC to DC is done by a rectifier, whereas DC to AC is done by an inverter, right? So inverter inverts direct current to an AC current, alternating current, does not generate electric power. The power is supplied from the battery. That is clear. The input voltage of the inverter is a constant DC power source, right? So whatever is supplied from the battery is a constant voltage DC power source for the inverter. The frequency remains unchanged. It takes a supply from the AC source and charges the battery. During the power cut, inverter receives the supply from the battery and provides the power to electrical equipment, which is AC. After converting it into AC, it supplies power to the electrical equipment. So we have a comparison in terms of the definition which we saw function acts as a flywheel storage or a battery backup storage system, whereas here it is acting as a conversion device. Switch over immediate. UPS can quickly, we in fact told about the idea of UPS to provide uninterrupted power supply, whereas inverter could take time. Backup, UPS needs electricity to charge, whereas inverter needs DC battery to charge. Types, these types are something which we discussed in the previous slides. Inverter can be standalone and grid tie converter types. We will not get into the detail of those. And we have connected, this is directly connected to the appliance, this is connected to the battery, and in turn that gets connected to the appliances. Cost, UPS is expensive, inverter is relatively less expensive. Circuit, inverter and controller, and in fact we saw we need inverter, battery and the controller over here. Over it is over for the internet, it is just the battery. Supplying power is really, really, really short for UPS, whereas for inverter it can last for a longer time. Voltage fluctuation won't, that will also be taken care by an UPS, whereas inverter that is not separately taken care. Use, this is for domestic use and industrial use, and inverter only for domestic use. So what we have at our house is mostly an inverter. Most of the cases it is an inverter, unless and until we need really high capacity for high operating voltages or wattages, we don't use UPS at all. So on a surface level we can understand that the really big commercial facilities or public facilities are using UPS, whereas all that we use in our households are just inverter, which depends upon a battery. This is clear. We will move on to something called as the server power requirements. When we talk about server power requirements, we are talking about power requirements for critical areas. Critical areas, one is server power. The syllabus just specifies server power requirements, but we can also understand this is operation theater, server power requirements, and IT hubs and power plant operations, wherever you have a major risk if there is no power cut. Such areas, how can we go about such areas with respect to the power requirements? A server is a computer, so I don't think you guys as a generation would want me to explain what is a server. Nevertheless, a server is a computer designed to process requests and deliver data to another computer over any network. On an average, 45 to 60 watts per square foot is typical for a server room. Okay, in terms of power, however, if it is a densely packed server room, it may require more power as well. But the server power will have extremely good lighting, UPS rack mounted fans to remove the heat, and a continuous supply of air conditioning, which will again can get converted into the power load, right? So there is number of outlets which could be required for each of this depending upon the server requirements, or any floor mounted outlets. We should be using power woods, which is outlets attached to flexible cabling, right? So instead of fixed outlets, so it won't be fixed on your wall. It has some provisions where you can, they can be a bit flexible than our wall sockets, right? Because for the obvious reason that some servers will be very mobile and they have the provision to move from one place to another. In such cases, cable length shouldn't be an issue. Right? The server's electrical load has to be distributed across the circuits and built into the expansion planning guidelines. The server's electrical load has to be distributed across the circuits and built into expansion planning guidelines. And cooling and ventilation power also have to be on its own to prevent power fluctuations. So I will explain about these. We will just complete reading the information that we have here. So all power cables should be shielded in a flexible steel conduit encased in a copper shield to, sorry, there's a mistake there, in a copper shield to prevent electrical noise from reaching our network cables and equipment. The power redundancy requirements for a Windows server room will depend upon the uptime requirements, which is the number of hours it is going to be up in a day. Data centers with domain controllers, DNS servers, web servers, and other mission critical systems will require backup generators as well as UPS units. Segregate the servers and circuits that will be tied to generator power, which will simply be tied to uninterruptible power supplies. And finally, we'll have to check the quality of power coming into the building to ensure that it meets the Indian standard code specifications. If not, we'll have to modify our devices accordingly. So these two slides, what if we have to put it short and summarize these two slides, it is important that we isolate this power. So let us understand the server room is going to have cables running up and down. So these servers that is just like our electrical panels is going to be boxes, right? Racks, boxes, and these are going to be, to be precise, these will be boxes which will have so much of cables inside them. And these cables usually come from the top or bottom depending upon the design and the availability of space. If it comes from the top, it comes from the false ceiling. Basically, it gets distributed to the entire floor. And if it is coming from the floor, we will have false flooring. And these false flooring or false ceiling will also have proper cable trays to take and carry these cables. And so when these cables come in, they are going to get connected to these servers, right? You will have a huge, this server is again a huge computer which is going to process so much of data and pass and going to bridge so much of communications between various other systems. So they will, just because of the number of cables that we have, they're going to generate a lot of heat as well. So there is a constant need to have unfluctuating power for these servers by itself. Then we talk about the accessories. So they need air conditioning systems. So those again require a separate power supply. And for maintenance issue and other purposes, or even the entire server room has to be lit properly. So the lights have to come into consideration. And under the false ceiling or false flooring, you will again need lights for maintenance. Those are again needed separately. And what else can we think of? So these are the major things, at least that one can think of. So, but the problem is, if I connect all of these server to the AC, to the lights which is in the room and also above or below the false ceiling or false flooring, if we connect all of these to the regular power, what happens is, if there is a power cut, the entire office is going to get shut. And if all these goes off, it's going to be a huge loss. If the company's major business is going to be IT and IT related stuff, so they can't afford to have this. But at the same time, we can't power a huge space with an alternator backup system. But so this entire system has to be accordingly planned, and of course we are going to spend a lot on this to make sure all this runs with just an uninterrupted power supply, irrespective of the number of hours it is going to run. And of course, another important factor which plays a major role is your affordability factor, right? So what happens is, we don't mix any of these lights or AC or server power or the sockets to the main supply. It is purely going to be connected to a separate source of power, right, which is your battery room. So in any case, of course, this will also have UPS in it. If there's a power outage, you can't afford to have any of this go off. So there is quickly a UPS system getting in and bridging the gap. And instead of a diesel generator, we are going to power it up with completely battery. And this is where electrical room, along with the electrical room, you will have, whenever you have a server room, you will also have a battery room next to it, where you can just see a series of racks with series of batteries connected to each other. They are not just going to help you with powering up the server for just a short span of time, but it is going to be there, meaning it is going to be there for a longer supply, right? So in such case, and of course some of these servers, they have backup servers, server 1, server 2, where server 1 works for 12 hours and server 2 works for another remaining 12 hours, and they have shifts for the servers as well, right? In such cases, how do we deal? How do we take care of this? In either cases, we again need a set of batteries or sources of power supply. So that also have to be, are we going to plan that also based on a shift? Or do we have enough capacities which can run around the clock, right? So these, depending upon the requirement, the entire setup can be connected. The entire power server room can be connected to a battery backup. Or let's say no, I'm good enough. I'm just a small company. I can just run it with just a battery backup time of couple of minutes or half an hour, where I can just switch everything off systematically, avoiding data breach, data loss. In such cases, of course, when there is a power outage, when there's a power failure, we should at least make sure two or three lights under the ceiling, above the ceiling, or whatever inside the room runs in such a fashion that we at least get time to see what's happening. So again, that cannot be connected to our regular power supply. In case even the DC also fails at such cases, that is when, or in case of a power, what do you say, fire, in case of fire where DG, the main power supply, everything fails, that's why some of the offices are even in your multiplexes will have some of these lights connected directly to the UPS. So these emergency lights, emergency signages, all these are usually connected to your UPS power supply. So in the worst case, at least these will be up and running so that they can safely evacuate and do the job in case of maintenance. So this is about our UPS and server power requirements. We move here to wiring. Wiring, we are not talking about regular wiring, we are talking about electrical wiring, which is by definition process of connecting various accessories for distribution of electrical energy from, over here it is said, suppliers meter board to home appliances to domestic appliances, basically from any supply to any demand. Whenever we connect that becomes our wiring. So there are several types and methods of wiring. One is by means of connection, right? By means of connection, number one is joint box system or jointing system or a T system, because it resembles the alphabet T. From the main distribution system, if you could see, this is phase and this is neutral. We have the main distribution system going up and the neutral going down, so we get it to switch one, lamp one, and this gets connected to neutral. This again switch two, lamp two, neutral. So this is how we connect in terms of the way we connect, and because of this particular system, how it looks in the plan or the layout, it is jointing system or T system, also called as joint box system. Number two is by means of connection again. Okay, this is an explanation to the previous slide. Connections through joints. Joints are made through connectors. And comparatively lesser cable, cheapest, balanced with joint boxes, suits temporary purposes. Number two is looping system or looping system, where this is a connection in parallel, feed conductor directly to terminal and then carried forward to the next. So from DB you have this connected, and the same wire connects switch to oil also, and the neutral comes to the other end of the lamp separately. So basically, if you can understand the difference between the first one, we connected one lamp with the phase, the same wire went and it connected back and it goes to the second switch in the previous, right? The power is connected, the power is connected, neutral is connected separately. So there are two wires which is connecting the switches together, and from the switch it goes to lamp and it is connected to the neutral. This is from the main distribution board. Over here we have the DB, whereas the same wire goes and connects all the switches together. Similarly, all the neutrals goes and connects to the other end of the lamp together, right? So there are a series of loops from one point to another. So these are all looped together, whereas in the first one they are made individually. That is joint system, this is looping system. Now we'll move on to the types of wiring system. We spoke about the methods of wiring. Now we are talking about the types of wiring systems. One is cleat wiring. This is how it looks. Use of wall tube wires are drawn from one to room to another, into another through partition wall. So this is how it looks in plan and elevation. I will show you images and you can probably relate it to it in a better way. Depending upon again where you come from, where you grew, and the buildings that you must have seen in your childhood days and schooling days, probably some of you have had an opportunity to witness these. The system of wiring comprises of ordinary VIIR, vulcanized insulated rubber, or PVC insulated wires, braided and compounded, held on walls or ceilings by means of porcelain cleats, plastic or wood. And the provision that you see here is for the wires to pass by, right? This is number one, cleat wiring, almost out of existence. Second is casing and capping wiring. So this is most of us must have seen this happening in many of the buildings that we see on an everyday basis. I personally feel the way it is used is, most of the time it sounds like it is an afterthought, because when you plan your buildings, the ones which you actually plan gets inside the surface where you chip off and put your conduits and take it out. Whenever you feel there's a necessity to do something for some other purpose later on after you construct the building, that is when casing and capping comes into existence. Get it, plan it, put on the surface of the wall, put the wire, put the cables, cover it off, right? So this is casing and capping, and this comes in plastic, fiber, so many other materials that comes in. The capping, over here it is told that the cable were carried through wooden casing enclosures. We're talking about a wooden casing here. The casing is made up of a strip of wood with parallel grooves cut lengthwise so that to accommodate cables. The grooves were made to separate opposite polarity. The capping also made of wood used to cover the wires and cables installed and fitted in the casing. So imagine it's going to be a U-shaped case which will be fixed onto the wall with screws, and you lay the cables over here in this view and finally cover it with another view. So all that you see is just this. I'll show you the next slide, maybe you can understand it better. Yes, so you see this happening. So this over here is a fire alarm panel. You have the casing coming in, and from which you have two or three wires branching out to the fire alarm panel. And this is again the same image I've just shown you. So one goes to the sensor, one goes to the hooter, one goes to some other, it goes to the next space, right? So this is our casing and capping wiring. Number three, yes, over here we have three types, which is batten wiring, CTS or TRS wiring. Again, a very old system, depending upon the buildings that you've seen in your school and schooling days in childhood. Probably some of you might have seen, or you might have missed this as well. So there will be a clip. These are the cables that carries wire, and this is the batten. Batten is the bed. Okay, the cables are held on the wooden batten by means of tin brass link clips, buckle clip, already fixed on the batten with brass pins and spaced at regular intervals. So this is the intervals that we are talking about. In this wiring system, wires sheet and tough rubber are used, which are quite flexible. They are clipped on wooden battens with brass clips, linker joint, and fixed onto the walls or ceilings by flat head screws. These cables are moisture and chemical proof. This is one big advantage that these cables still have. They are suitable for damp climate but not suitable for outdoor use in sunlight. TRS wiring is suitable for lighting in low voltage installations. So CTS is cap tire sheath, TRS is tough rubber sheathing, right? So this is based on the materials that we use for sheathing. One is cap tire sheathing and next is tough rubber sheath. So this is the sheathing that we have. These are the actual wires, and this is the insulation, and this is the bed, which is the sheath, and this is the clips which hold the wires together, right? Okay, here, yeah, I've given the expansion. And we have type 4 as well, which is lead sheath wiring. Over here, the material that we have is lead as the final covering, which is the sheath. So inside we again have the copper conductors, and insulators, and also another layer called serving, and finally the lead covering. The type of wiring employs conductors that are insulated with vulcanized Indian rubber and covered with an outer sheath made of lead aluminium alloy containing about 95% of lead. The metal sheath given protection to cables from mechanical damage. So basically, yes, it protects the cables. The whole covering is made electrically continuous and connected to earth, and protect against electrolytic action due to leakage, current leakaging, and provide safety in the case. And moving on further, we have next typing as well, which is conduit wiring. And this is something which we have been seeing, or we must have definitely seen in the present context. One is what we see here is there are two types which is seen. I would want you to guess. So this is type 1 and this is type 2. I'll explain about this to you. In the meantime, if you can make a guess, you're welcome to do. Right. And again, over here I am again showing you a couple of types. If you can guess, this is concealed because you don't see any conduits here, right? And if one is concealed, the next one has to be surface conduit wiring. So under conduit wiring, we have two types: one is surface, one is concealed, right? Now again, taking this example back, whoever is guessed, let us discuss that. So types of wiring, and we're talking about conduits here. So types of conduit wiring: one is metal, next is non-metallic, right? So metal conduits are made of steel, of course, which are very strong but expensive as well. There are two types of metallic conduits. Again, in under metallic conduits, we have a couple of classes depending upon the gauge limit of the steel that we get, right? Low and high. Non-metallic is solid PVC conduit, which is flexible and easy to bend. And over here, I have given some of the types, sizes of conduits which you can go through. And this is about comparison between each of these wiring techniques and how they perform with respect to each other in terms of life, cost, mechanical protection, possibility of fire, protection from dampness, type of labor required, installation, inspection, repair, and popularity, right? So if you could remember which wiring, so cleat, batten, I told you the old methods of wiring, casing, camping, capping, and conduit. So life is relatively better in conduit, and cost is of course depending upon metallic conduit or non-metallic, it is going to change, but yes, it offers good protection. Fire possibility is relatively less when you talk about metal, but when you talk about plastic, it burns off, it melts. Protection from dampness is again good, especially when it is plastic and fiber, it is going to be really good. Type of labor required, it's going to be skilled because it requires coordination between other parties. When you're going to put a concealed conduits, it is going to require coordination from other operating agencies, right? So installation, if you must have seen a conduit wire and conduit installation, you could have seen that when we put it in the ceilings, it requires proper planning. It has to maintain a particular distance, and you put the cover blocks and all that to make sure it doesn't come out, and you need to cover the top properly when you plaster so that it doesn't get filled. At the same time, when you do it in the wall, you have to chip off the concrete or the brick and then put it inside properly, bury them inside, again plaster without any undulations. So it requires skilled installation. And when it is again concealed, you will have to open it there. When in case of casing capping, batten or cleat, it is all on the surface. So in case of maintenance, it is very easy for them to locate and maintain the locate the fault and maintain a repair. And popularity is something which we can decide as and time moves forward. So as of now, yeah, conduit wiring reduces the work. Anything that reduces our work and makes a job easy becomes popular. So yes, so this is a comparison of different wiring systems. With this, we have covered everything. I will just give a quick summary of some of the components that we have already discussed, and also a quick introduction to the devices that we are going to see in the next couple of chapters, third module to be precise. So electrical service connection and meter, fuse, distribution box, we have studied some of it. Main switch, MCCB, RCCB is something which you have not seen, which is going to be seen in our module 3. Branch circuit breakers, fuses are all something which we will study in our module 3. Devices, wall switches, plug sockets, electrical wires and cables. Right. So here some of it we have studied, some of it we will see. We will discuss about them in module 3. And one thing which which is missing here is point wiring and point matrix. Point wiring, usually when this matrix is something which I will talk about this when we do our electrical layout or lighting layout, but otherwise when you have a huge office, we talk about this data points, data cables. Imagine a floor full of an office floor with 100 employees sitting in different lines, x-axis and y-axis. They all are going to need LAN connections with systems, right? Because they have their workstations, work desk. So how do you locate the points? So that becomes a matrix of the points that we have. The same system is applicable for our wiring also. In our house, whichever points we have, this connection in series, connection in parallel, whatever connection is going to happen behind, what is the number of points, on what basis are we locating the points, electrical point outlets, or even our lighting points. So whichever point or outlet that require powers, that is going to be your point wiring, and the matrix is going to address the same thing in X and Y axis. I think we have come to the end of this module. In the next session, we will be studying about renewable energy system and energy conservation based on energy conservation in building code. And that would help us complete module 2, right? So let's meet each other in the next class. Thank you.